we're back to more of It's Janice. I'm your host, Janice McLean Deloach, and I've been joined with the director, Mr. William Honenbloom. Hi.
Hello.
Who is in charge of the Raymond V. Haysbert Center for Entrepreneurship. So, thank you for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.
Tell me what brings you to the Greater Baltimore Urban League and how you became the director of the Raymond V. Haysbert Center.
Well, I've been an Urban Leaguer for almost 2 decades. It's one of those things that you say, once an Urban Leaguer, always an Urban Leaguer. Okay. I joined the Urban League through its young professional program. In Baltimore, it's called the Greater Baltimore Leadership Association. In that program, it was a wonderful opportunity to get to not only network with other young professionals in the community, but also to work with them on service projects and enhancing the quality of life for the people that we serve. Mm-hmm. During that tenure, I was able to grow in the Urban League and grow professionally as well. I became chair of their political empowerment committee, became treasurer, eventually president of the local chapter. I also became treasurer of the national young professional movement. And at each step, I learned more about the Urban League and its commitment to changing lives. Mm-hmm. I also, during that time, was developing my own business, part law practice, part business consulting. And what happened was that this opportunity opened up. In the wake of some of the things, unfortunate things that happened in Baltimore with the uprising and riots.
Let me just go back, if you don't mind. What's the opportunity that opened up for you?
This center. This center has only been in existence since June of 2016, so not very long. Mm-hmm. During that time, we've been able to help hundreds of people work on their business and develop some business skills that they didn't have before. And so when they were looking to open the center, they looked for someone to lead it who had some business experience, who understood the Baltimore market, and who had done business consulting. J. Howard Henderson, the president of the Baltimore Urban League, gave me a call and said, I think this is what we need you for. And at first I was like, oh, okay, maybe. But as I got to understand the full opportunity just to help people build businesses, to change the Baltimore business ecosystem, and to transform lives, it was something that I had to do.
And you know, I couldn't imagine a better person than you for this position.
Thank you.
Because you know, as an entrepreneur, and we've talked about this a little bit off camera, you need people that inspire you and motivate you.
Absolutely.
And you have some history on what it's like to be an entrepreneur and
absolutely.
A business person. Which I think is very important, and we'll get to that a little bit later
okay.
in the interview. So tell me one of the most important decisions you've had to make working in this position with the entrepreneurs and small businesses.
One of the biggest decisions that we had to make when we were doing the initial planning of the center is what direction to go in and what type of clients to target. We could have decided that we're gonna target the high-end client, high-growth client off the break. And really focus our energy there. But that wouldn't be true to who we are as an Urban League.
Right.
The Urban League has always been about helping those who need it most, not the ones who give us the best return on investment or the best return.
Okay.
So what we decided
Thank
to,
you for that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But what we decided to do is to make sure that we kept our programs community focused, integrated in the community. Where there are some we're called technical assistance providers. That's kind of the name of choice right now. But where other technical assistance providers, you come
and
to.
What does that mean? What exactly is that term? Let's for
can
those
we, can we
them,
just talk plainly?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. One of the things that happens is that technical assistance provider is a fancy name for business support. We help with business plans. We help with understanding financial management, business development, human resources, and there are a lot of different technical assistance providers. Now that term is just very broad and encompasses a lot, but we focus in on those areas. We also focus in a lot on helping business owners who have great dreams, great aspirations, and great motivation. Mm-hmm. We help them figure out a plan. When I was young, my mom used to always say, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail.
Absolutely.
And I mm-hmm. thought that was just something really cool that she would say, and it mm-hmm. sounded good. But as an entrepreneur, there is no bigger truth. You have opportunities that abound all around you, but if you're not mm-hmm. prepared to take advantage of them, you may get a contract that sounds wonderful. It may be the one you're looking for, but if you're not prepared, if you are not planned to handle that contract, you could end up doing more damage to your company than not having that contract at all.
And this is why I think you are perfect for this position, because actually I made that very same mistake when I was doing the pantyhose vending machines, but I digress, we're not gonna talk about that. And a lot of it was, I didn't do the planning. And so it's very important that you're focusing on that, because it has a lot to do with the end result.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
There are skill sets that you're gonna need to develop. There are opportunities and ways to analyze those opportunities and ensure that they fit your business, that if you haven't taken those steps to plan for, then anything can happen.
Okay. Tell me one characteristic you feel every entrepreneur, business leader, business owner,
one characteristic, motivation. I tell entrepreneurs all the time, I can teach you how to plan business, I can teach you how to manage your finances, I may even be able to teach you how to do portions of your business. I can't teach you how to hustle. I can't teach you how to grind.
Okay.
If you don't have the motivation, if something is not in you that wakes you up in the morning to do the work, there's nothing that we can do. But you may not have the technical skills, but if you have that motivation, and the second one, which is almost as important, is adaptability. If you wake up in the morning with the motivation and you have a mindset that is adaptable and amenable to change, I can take you wherever you need to go.
Wow, and that's a great point. I'll just kind of point out Polaroid.
That is a great example.
And Kodak.
Yeah.
Refused to change. Refuse to adapt to the current climate in the country today.
Absolutely. It is amazing that if you think about the market share that Kodak and Polaroid had, they were virtually the entire photography market. But because they didn't make, they could have been on the cutting edge with their technology integrated into the smartphones of now as that was progressing, but they never believed it was going to happen. Another great example is the railways. There was a decision that they had to make at one point, whether they were going to focus mostly on transporting cargo or transporting people. They saw the infrastructure development of the highways, they saw the advancement of airplane technology, and they decided that they'd have a better push in in transporting cargo from place to place. Now, that has gotten them that made them a stable staple of commerce. But the growth that could have been seen if they had really moved up adapted to that change and added infrastructure to their ability to transport people around would have been phenomenal.
Wow. Okay. So motivation and adaptability.
Yes.
Okay. What's the best way to innovate?
The best way for entrepreneurs to innovate is to focus on their clients. We tell entrepreneurs all the time, if you don't have revenue and if you don't have clients, then you just have a hobby that somebody may give you money for from time to time. You have to focus on the needs.
Why do all of these things sound like my previous road here? So, okay, right?
If you don't understand the need of your customers or their desires or what they're willing to pay for, you're not going to be able to innovate. Because if you innovate for yourself, unless you're writing your own checks, it becomes this circular position. If you innovate, if you figure out what the needs of your clients are, what their desires are, what they're willing to pay for, you can innovate into a market space. A lot of the great successes that we hear about and we celebrate often happen because they recognize what the customer wanted. A great example is Microsoft. Microsoft realized that people weren't really interested in all of the technical advances that the computer brought with it. What they did understand people did want was low price. So instead of, they changed the entire market space because they realized that they needed standardized operating systems across multiple platforms. And it gave them an entree into a whole new market space. And now when they saw it, and kind of going back to the innovation, they realized that people were now, this internet thing was happening. And so what they did is they created browsers because they saw it was coming. They saw that people were looking for it. They weren't the first, but they understood the market need and did it in a way that their customers wanted. And they still maintain, you know, the lion's share of the browser market internationally.
Now, actually, that's a good point that you bring up. One of the questions that I wanted to ask you is, how has social media and the internet changed the space for entrepreneurs and business owners?
Well, the primary impact that the internet and social media has had on entrepreneurship is that it's reduced many of the barriers to entry. Before, getting people to become aware of that you even existed as a business was huge.
Right.
Newspaper ads, radio ads, television ads, all of these very expensive modalities of communicating with the masses. Well, now
most entrepreneurs don't have and can't
absolutely
afford, which is,
it, and that's why the landscape was left to these large corporations, because they can get people aware of their products, their services, any innovation, any new products that they had. They could do that in relative ease because they had the deep pockets. Well, now with social media, mastery of a Facebook, Instagram, Reddit, any of these sites, understanding how Google Analytics work and things like that give entrepreneurs the same opportunities that the large corporation has. Even better, though, because entrepreneurs are with their clients. So they understand their clients, the way that a lot of these social media platforms work is that you're linked by commonality. And so that commonality is something that will drive the entrepreneurs not just to understand who their target market is, but having the ability to communicate with them in a way that's common to all of them. So it's changed the game. A lot of entrepreneurs, for entrepreneurs now, social media isn't an option. It is a requirement. Now, there are certain segments of the population where, like my dad, I love my dad to death. My dad is 76 years old. Mm-hmm. He had a Nokia flip phone for the last 20 years. The last 18 years, literally a Nokia flip phone, and it broke last year, later in the year, and he got a smartphone, and it's been so adorable that he's been trying to explain to me how smartphones work. But the thing to remember is that even though my father has a smartphone, he is part of that small market share that
right.
You're not going to be able to, if you want to get some effort, he's part of your target market, you need to show up at the church, you need to show up at the community rec center, or you need to get something to the house. So unless you have a narrow target like 76-year-old men,
right.
You need social media, particularly if you're looking for a lot of growth quickly, because the millennials are fairly integrated into social media like it is part of them.
Right, that's true.
My oldest son is a millennial, and his phone
it's
is
like
attached.
The phone. It's like
it is surgically integrated. I don't even know if he has a hand anymore. I don't know if he has a hand. It's just a phone at the end with fingers on it.
Right.
But that's how, if you want to get some information to him, you need to make sure that you understand how Facebook works. You need to understand, and with not just understanding how it works, understanding how to read it. A lot of times people think reading Facebook is just looking at the posts. But if you work with Facebook, the analytics on Facebook and Google are phenomenal. They will break down and help you understand who does what, who says what, who likes what. So it makes the targeting for entrepreneurs even easier.
Okay. Now let me put this hat on and say, how does it hurt those businesses and entrepreneurs?
The businesses that are hurt most often by social media are the ones that don't understand it well. If they don't understand, or not, and again, not just about social media, but understanding your target market.
Okay.
There are some, for example, there are some vendors who, or some entrepreneurs who are in food services, and they understand the technical context and the superiority of their product, but they don't understand that it needs to be visually appealing.
Wow. Okay. Well, this is really good. We can sit here and we go on and on and on. We actually like to talk to each other a lot. But what we're going to do is we're going to take a break for a few minutes. We're going to go to commercial break, and we'll be back with more. Director William Honeyblue, who is at the Greater Baltimore Urban League's Raymond B. Haysbert Center for Entrepreneurship.
Welcome to Sizzling Bombay. I'm Chef Mahindra. Please come to our restaurant and enjoy authentic flavors of India with great atmosphere, friendly staff, and great food. And enjoy live belly dance every Wednesday from 7:30 to 8 p.m. Please visit us at 2108 Amerton Road, Suite 3, Bel Air, and live.
More of It's Janice. That's me, your host, Janice McLean Deloach. I'm joined by Mr. William A. Honeyblue, who's the director for the Raymond B. Haysbert Center for Entrepreneurship at the Greater Baltimore Urban League in Baltimore. So we're back I just want to go back to that last thing about the cell phones with the kids and my, you know, I was at home and I asked my son to do something and my phone went off and I heard this little beep, you know, you get up now, you walk to the phone. Mm-hmm. And he's like, I'm upstairs. Yeah. Like, well, I know you're in the house. So, come down. So anyway, social media, it's an interesting thing.
Absolutely.
Now, let's talk about how the Urban League reaches out to the community. Mm-hmm. How do you get people to come in to the Raymond V. Haysbert Center and talk about entrepreneurship and small business? I know you've been doing it for years, but what's changed now?
Well, one of the things that's changed is that the opportunity actually exists for people to get services. There was a pent-up demand in Baltimore, particularly in marginalized and minority communities, because the reality is that for a lot of minority communities, there's a distrust of institutions, particularly government-related institutions. And so they don't necessarily access the services at those institutions because of that history. The Urban League doesn't face that same challenge. We've been in the community for over 100 years, and people understand what we're here for. They understand that we're here to help. They understand that we're here to empower them and to change their lives. Mm-hmm. So there's a level of trust that exists that we have earned over time.
Yeah.
And we're able to capitalize on that. And so once people understood that our services were here, was available and free, they flocked. The Urban League enjoys a trust with the community. Mm-hmm. We've been doing this for 100 years, and people understand who we are and what we're here to do. So once people found out that the services were available and they didn't have to pay for them, they flocked to the services. We stay busy. And we make sure that people understand that we're here to help. Our goal is to help people develop businesses so that they can create legacies of wealth for their families.
You know, I'm glad you brought that up.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, and I'm just, again, we're having an honest conversation.
Yes.
When people talk about the National Urban League, the NAACP, Rainbow Push, I'm missing one.
And the other
historical black institutions that were always the backbone of our communities, it feels like there's a disconnect, like, you know, we've lost those voices. You know, these organizations still exist, but rarely are we seeing them giving back to the community. And let me just even go into this.
Okay.
In light of Black History Month and Women's History Month, I did some research, particularly because I was working on my own book, which we talked a little bit about, and I noticed that there were 5 black millionaires between the late 1800s through 1926.
Okay.
And this was a trick question that we talked about earlier.
People
know Madam C.J. Walker, but a lot of them don't know that she worked for a millionaire who actually brought her into that hair care industry.
Mm-hmm.
And that was Annie Malone. And I'll tell you something else that's even I found interesting. I could be wrong. I want everybody to do their homework. You got your phone on you?
Yeah, I got my phone.
Let's take a look. Little quick quiz and see if I'm right about this.
Okay.
Wouldn't that be something if I discovered a mistake in history? You know,
that would be something.
That would be interesting.
So what are we looking at?
As smart as I think I am, let's see if I'm right.
Okay.
So look up Madam C.J. Walker. All right, everybody, look up Madam C.J. Walker, right? And look at the photo that comes up. It's a woman with her hair kind of in a bob cut.
Yes, that is exactly the one that comes up most often.
Under C.J. Walker, right? Now type in Lyda Newman, L-Y-D-A.
Right.
N-E-W-M-A-N. And then take a look at the photo that comes up.
Oh, I'm sorry, my phone autocorrect. I'm
Lyda,
sorry.
Lyda, L-Y-D-A.
Yeah, it actually changed it. There we go.
Newman.
Yes, the inventor of the hairbrush.
But who? Look at the photo.
The photo is the same photo of Madam C.J.
Walker. C.J. Walker.
Mm-hmm.
So there you have it. I am really smart. Yeah. But Lyda Newman, the photo that comes up of C.J. Walker is actually Lyda Newman.
Okay.
They're not the same photo.
Are they the same person, though?
They're not.
So that wasn't her name before she got married?
No.
Oh, okay.
They're two totally different people.
That's interesting. Huh. Google could be wrong.
Maybe.
That sounds real big to say Google is wrong.
So I'm not going to say it. We're just going to say, go look at the photos. Anyway, so here's the point.
Uh-huh.
There were 5 black millionaires between the late 1800s and the early 1900s.
Mm-hmm.
Four of them were sister girls. They hung out together.
Uh-huh.
Mary McLeod Bethune, Annie Malone, Madam C.J. Walker, and Lyda Newman.
Yep.
And so when I fast forward from the late 1920s to 1960, nothing was happening in between.
And I don't think that's true.
That's what I want to know.
Yeah.
Did we just stop dreaming and inventing? What happened in that 50-year span?
It wasn't that we stopped dreaming or inventing. Just like now, it's not that these things, the organizations that you mentioned before, aren't doing anything. What they're doing is now become normal. It wasn't so much that black people stopped innovating and stopped growing businesses, because after the time frame you're talking about, that's when Black Wall Street and these types of places emerged. Mm-hmm. But the issue is that it became normal. See, the five women you're talking about, they transformed society, and that's why their attention is gathered there.
Okay.
Nobody talks about what you did today because it's what you're supposed to do today. What you're doing is normal. When you're looking at children's development as an example, the first steps, everybody celebrates. There's pictures, there's video, and there's all that. The 72,435th step, nobody even cares.
Okay, that's it's nice.
Like,
right.
Nobody mm-hmm. cares. That's what it became.
Okay.
African Americans now saw these women, these trailblazers that had transformed the landscape, and they were like, I can do that. It's no longer extraordinary. Mm-hmm. It is now the norm. Success was no longer something that we had to celebrate every time, because it's just what we do now. That is how the dynamics get changed. That's how society moves. In our histories, we focus on exponential change and exponential growth, but the reality is, it is the increase, the slight increases day by day by day that make the change, and that's where you see progress in the aggregate when you take a step away. That is what happened. That is the difference. And going back to the opening of your questions about the civil rights organizations.
And I love them. I'm not bad.
Absolutely.
I don't want to get any emails from everybody going, you.
Well, you know what? Have them say, if they have emails, they can send them to me and I'll finish up the answer.
Yeah.
The issue is that they understood that they understand that while there is a place for disruption, there are a place for these things, that more progress, social progress, can be made by sitting at a table and negotiating things. Because my reality is that power gives nothing unless it's at the end of a spear. But you can negotiate with power to get progress. And so
clarify that for me. I'm a little slow sometimes. Okay.
So what happened before is that the system had to be fought. And that's where everybody's emphasis was. Everybody is fighting the system very publicly, demonstrations and things, and standing out and against what has happened.
Even with like the Black Lives Matter, like right now.
And so what's happened is that the Black Lives, that's a great example. The Black Lives Matter movement has become the agitating voice of a community. But on the other side, there's still, once agitation has occurred, there still needs to be organizations that help programs to support. So, for example, there were in Baltimore's history, I want to say it was late 60s, can't be quoted on that, when they realized that the Baltimore Fire, it may have actually been earlier than that, the Baltimore Fire Department hadn't been integrated. And what happened was that the fire department created a test that maybe not designed to keep African Americans out, but did a good job of it. And so they pushed, and the community pushed, and that's when they came up with the test to keep African Americans out. It was designed and had that effect. So nobody could pass the test, so nobody actually was able to get a job as a fireman. What the Baltimore Urban League did was to create a program to educate people who were otherwise qualified to be firemen to take the test and pass it so they could get in. That is not about agitation. That is about creating a pathway to success.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And that's what's happening in the background. Just because you don't see us on TV arguing and debating, there are people who need to do that. That is absolutely appropriate, and it is a necessary part of the civil rights struggle. It is a necessary part of the movement. But there also needs to be people, organizations that are in the background helping to develop individuals. Now, the Black Lives Matter movement and some of our other partners, they're out talking about the need to have more African-American entrepreneurs engaged in government contracts, mm-hmm. getting these larger bids. The Urban League right now is helping entrepreneurs become available, so when those opportunities come, they're able to take advantage of them. Okay. Otherwise, you'll have a whole lot of opportunities, and then the people in power will say, well, see, we opened the opportunity, and you couldn't take it, so let's just shut it back down.
Right.
Oh, no, open up the opportunity, and I will give you people who are capable of doing it, because we will help them grow and become everything they need to be to change the world.
Okay. Wow. Okay. And certainly, I'll do whatever I can. I've been doing it.
And you have. Absolutely.
Been, right.
You have shared, I'm sorry, and I know you're going to talk about this later, but I really think that we need to acknowledge the fact that your book, Autobiography of an Entrepreneur, is part of that solution process. Because one of the things entrepreneurs a lot of times feel is that I'm in this by myself. Nobody understands what's going on.
Right.
You sharing your story changes that dynamic. And having watched you struggle through your literature and understanding that success can come on the other side, it sends a message to other entrepreneurs out here that it may be dark right now, but joy comes in the morning.
Wow. Yeah. Thank you for that. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.
And, you know, and I want to thank people like Raymond V. Haysbert.
Oh, yeah.
Who came before me and Pork Sausage was the name of the company.
Absolutely. You mind if I talk about Mr. Haysbert?
Absolutely. I would love for you to.
There are 13 entrepreneurship centers in the United States in the Urban League movement. This is the only one named after someone. And because in Baltimore, Raymond V. Haysbert Sr. was known for decades as the dean of black business in Baltimore. In addition to taking Pork Sausage's public, one of the first two, and I think Bob Johnson was the other, to take black companies public on the New York Stock Exchange in a time where nobody really wanted that to happen. He helped found the Greater Baltimore Black Chamber of Commerce. He helped found the President's Roundtable, which is a group of African Americans who have high revenues. And when I first heard about it, I was like, oh, this is an opportunity for them to get together and make sure they stay in power. It wasn't. The core mission of it is to expand opportunities for African Americans, women, and other minorities so that more of them can perform at that level. He could have just turned, at his level of success, he could have turned his back on as many people as he wanted. And nobody would have.
He was not like that.
He was not like
that
at
all.
One of the stories that once I started working here, his daughter Nikita told me is at his funeral. A gentleman said, can I tell you about your dad? And, you know, people have been saying really great things about him all day. And she said, fine. He said there was one day in the 1960s where he was walking home in the rain from work. And this car pulled alongside of him and said, do you need a ride? It's pouring down rain. Give him car fare for the rest of the week. The guy went over to Pork Sausages figuring he'd meet like a plant, you know, a line manager, whatever. And they said, well, oh, Ray Haysbert, you want to go to the CEO suite? What happened? The what? Well, I don't think he was CEO, but to his suite, and it was like, okay. And he worked with him. He mentored him. Now, that's a great part of the story, but watch this. He mentored him and gave him an opportunity to meet with one of his, another black business leader to pitch his business once he felt he was ready. But that was one of the other things. He wasn't going to put you out there if you weren't ready.
Okay.
But once you were ready, he wasn't going to let you stay hidden. So he sent him out to meet with this guy, and the guy, he met with him, and he didn't get the business. The beauty of it is that Mr. Haysbert had a relationship with the potential client, and the client told him what he did wrong. And so he went back and told the gentleman, and the gentleman made corrections and went to another business presentation, and he got the job. He got the business and was able to grow. And he told Nikita, he said, because of your father, I was able to send my kids to college.
Wow.
I was able to create jobs in our community. That is what Raymond Haysbert's legacy is to Baltimore. And not just Baltimore, the region.
Right.
And that's what we want to do in this entrepreneurship center.
And, you know, even Henry Baines is another one who owned,
absolutely.
I forget the name of the supermarket now. But those
was it
guys,
Super Pride?
Super Pride.
Yeah.
And those guys got together. And
exactly.
They really, and sometimes I wonder why we can't seem to do that now. And if you want to do it, people think it's something wrong with you because you want to help, you know. Or
one of the reasons I've seen is that our values have shifted. It has shifted to what's in it for me? What am I going to get? And not even in the long term, but in the short term, not realizing if you operate from a place of finite resources, you will always be in competition with somebody else. If you understand that the pie is big enough for all of us to eat, you're going to work together so everybody gets fed. That is, I think, where we lack. We teach our kids to compete with each other. Why can't you be more like him? We teach our politicians. We teach, and don't get it twisted, we teach our politicians how to behave and by our responses to their behaviors. We teach our business owners how to behave based on our behaviors. And we reward them for fighting. Whoever wins, and think about where you get the most money in entertainment now. MMA, football,
reality
some of these
television,
reality
yeah.
television, mm-hmm. even it is how real can we make the competition and the destruction? That is where the money goes. And us rewarding that behavior
by watching the programs,
buying the products,
mm-hmm.
will just exacerbate the situation we're living in. At the Haysbert Center, one of the things that we do is we introduce our clients to our other clients. There are many consultants that we have that work with clients that are also clients. Because it doesn't help me to have you advising my clients when your business is in shambles.
Right.
We are working together because we're all in this together.
And there's I'm trying to come down too.
Oh, and I appreciate
the
time you have.
You never stop learning and you never stop growing Absolutely. And developing. And I, you know, as much as I'd like to say I have it all together, I don't. But I'm very willing to make sure that I get it right. So I certainly
Absolutely.
Will come down.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So how about we take a tour of the center?
Sounds great.
And how do people contact you if they want to get help for their businesses and entrepreneurs?
The best way to do it is to contact Michelle. At she manages our entire calendar
Michelle
and everything.
Michelle is wonderful. Thank you.
Awesome. mm-hmm. The number here is 410-523-8150, mm-hmm. extension 702. And I have no
Michelle
idea.
Michelle Holcomb.
Michelle Holcomb. She is the best thing to happen to our center aside from Mr. Haysbert himself.
And if she puts it on the calendar, it'll definitely happen. You can say that. So, all right, well, we're going to
real quick, too. Mm-hmm. You talked about social media, and I would be remiss if I didn't let you all know that we are on Facebook. It's the Haysbert Center for Entrepreneurship at the Greater Baltimore Urban League on Facebook.
Say again.
The Haysbert Center, HAYSBERT. CENTER.
Okay, on Facebook.
On Facebook right, and Twitter and Instagram.
Right.
I'm sorry, I'm looking to make sure that I say
that's
it all right.
Okay, that's okay. Oh my gosh. Okay, so guys, we are going to take a break. And when we come back with more of It's Janice, we're going to give you a brief tour of the Raymond B. Haysbert Center. If you want to reach out to the center and find out how you can donate resources, if you want to become a mentor, if you are a client that needs help from the center, this is Greater Baltimore Urban League, downtown Baltimore, but I'm sure, you know, no matter where you are, there is a center that you can connect them with to get the resources and help.
And we are, while we are in Baltimore, we're not geographically bound. I have clients on the Eastern Shore. We actually even have a client in China that we work with.
Okay.
So if you need help, we got help.
Okay. All right, and so this is my pitch to you guys, but we're gonna hold that thought. We're gonna take a break, and when we come back, I'm gonna tell you my challenge to you guys in support of the Raymond V. Haysbert Center. Stay tuned, we'll be back.
Welcome to Sizzling Bombay. I'm Chef Mahindra. Please come to our restaurant and enjoy authentic flavors of India with great atmosphere, friendly staff, and great food. And enjoy live belly dance every Wednesday from 7:30 to 8 p.m. Please visit us at 2108 Amerton Road, Suite 3, Bel Air, and like us on Facebook.
More of It's Janice. I'm Janice McLean Deloach, and I've been joined by Director William Honablu Jr. At the Raymond V. Haysbert Center with the Greater Baltimore Urban League downtown. So here's the challenge. I wrote this book. This is my book called Autobiography of an Entrepreneur. We talked a little bit about earlier. The challenge is that some of the hurdles and things that I went through, but it's really not about the book. So if you buy a book, that's great, because I'm going to donate $5 of every book sale to the Raymond Haysbert V. Center. That is not to encourage book sales. If you buy them, great, but I hope you learn something from the book. But it is to put my money where our talk just was. Whether it's $5 or $35, maybe it could help buy some business cards for somebody at the center, because there were days that I couldn't even afford business cards. So it's kind of hard to be professional when you're writing your name and your business down on paper to hand it to people, even though they may throw it in the way or they might take pictures and, you know, social media and all that kind of stuff. It's still important to have some kind of seed money, so that's my challenge. Autobiography of an Entrepreneur, it's on Amazon.com. The money will go $5 from every book sale. The book's $20 will go to
Thank
the
you.
Raymond V. Haysbert Center. So that's my pitch. I know there's more of you out there who've got a lot more money than I have. Call up, make a donation, make a contribution, help support the center. Let's plant the seeds of entrepreneurship and small businesses again, get these businesses growing and create some jobs in our community. So that's all I've got on that.
Thank you very much.
Okay. All right, guys, so now we're going to go take a tour of the Raymond V. Haysbert Center. Stay tuned, we'll be back. In the meanwhile, the credits are going to roll, and I'm not going to come back. We're just going to show you photos of the actual center. If you want to learn more about It's Janice, you can go to www.janice.media. I'll see you again on the next segment. Thanks for watching.
Alumni is Tuskegee Airmen alumni jacket is one of the most prized display items that we have here, because this is part of our history. It's also a statement of who this man was. He volunteered for service to protect our country at a time where our country was not very fond of people like him. But he did his service, he did his duty to protect us, and he grew as an individual. And I think that in his time as a Tuskegee Airman, it helped solidify some of the foundation, which later became the legend that he is. Okay, let's take you over this way and take a look at some of the other pieces. The Haysbert family has been very helpful and very supportive in the center and ensuring that we have some of the memorabilia from Mr. Haysbert so that we can effectively tell his story. Let's take a look at that. These are some of the pictures that Mr. Haysbert and Park Sausages under his leadership. You can see the type of production that they were doing. And one of the things to remember is that this wasn't just about business. These are jobs. These are people whose lives were changed because of the innovation and the adaptability that Mr. Haysbert demonstrated. This is a wall of some of his awards and achievements. As you can see, the city of Baltimore honored him numerous times, covers of magazines and the like. And these are literally not even a full fraction of the things that the honors and accomplishments and accolades that he received, but just a sample of the greatness that was him.